Welcome to the InfoWars Nightly News. I'm David Knight. It's Tuesday, February 17th, 2015. Here are top stories.
Tonight, how an angry mom became the poster child for the vaccine industry. Then, the FAA's rules for private drones. And how the NSA is doing more than just spying. That's next on the InfoWars Nightly News.
Why you hating?
I'm hating because they're killing. And when they're killing, then I'm hating.
When they're killing, you're illing?
Well, tonight we're going to take a look at some of the lies that are being used to panic people into war, into taking away informed consent, even running them out onto the airport tarmac like lemmings, where they can get sucked up into airplane engines or run over by airplanes where they really are in danger. First, let's take a look at what a German television station is doing. Of course, this German television channel ran a false report of Russian tanks being caught crossing into the Ukraine. The caption said, Russian armored vehicles moved through Izvorino in the Lugansk region February 12, 2015. The problem is that the image was from 2009, from a different place, South Ossetia, not the Ukraine. And the interesting thing about this is that it was found by a citizen media monitoring group. This is not something that the professional media caught. Of course, the people at the German station just pass it on. It was caught by the citizens, just like Brian Williams' lies. Now, look at what happened in LAX. In LAX, a mistaken public announcement saying that a gunman was on the loose at LA International Airport sent 20 passengers fleeing from the gate area onto the tarmac. Onto the tarmac, where the planes are. This is the level of sheepish panic that we're seeing in the country. And there's some real danger, not only about goading us into war, but also about destroying our fundamental liberties, taking away informed consent, the cornerstone of keeping in check medical tyranny, something that was highlighted as not being strong enough when the Nuremberg Codes came in, but something that goes to our individual rights to make decisions about our lives. What kind of medical treatment we're going to have is a fundamental decision that we should all be able to make. But of course, Obamacare first entrenched on it, forcing us to buy insurance that was mandated. Now they're talking about actually injecting us. And of course, the principle is essentially the same. But look at the way the media is pushing this. We had the Daily Mail, of course, last week, putting out a mom's angry Facebook post blaming anti-vaccine people for her son being exposed to measles. They said that her son, this is the way the Daily Mail put it, her son's life was hanging in the balance from measles. Yet the reality, something a little bit different. Let's play that clip.
On Facebook, she posted, "If you have chosen to not vaccinate yourself or your child, I blame you. I blame you. You have stood on the shoulders of our collective protection for too long. From that high height, we have given you the privilege of our protection for free. And in return, you gave me this week, a week from hell, wherein I don't know if my baby will develop something that has death as a potential outcome. Today, York Region has confirmed one case of measles in a man under 30.
This person was previously vaccinated.
Now, of course, in the video clip, they point out that the person that actually exposed the people in the waiting room to measles, none of whom have come down with the measles, but that person was not an unvaccinated person. That person had been vaccinated. From the original story, they say the York Region public health officials confirmed Wednesday that there was one known case of the virus in the area north of Toronto and said that the man, who is younger than 30, had been vaccinated, as you just heard them report. Nevertheless, they pushed the narrative that was the unvaccinated people that were to blame for this. And when you look at the headlines, it says, Canadian mother's powerful post on measles, I blame you. And the media never pointed out the dissonance in that statement, the untruth in that statement. Now, one of the things that was in the original Daily Mail story saying that she still had to wait a few more days to find out if her son even had the measles. So first they report that her son's life is hanging in the balance from being exposed to measles, or not from being exposed to measles, but hanging in the balance from measles. Then they say, well, we got to wait to see if he's even got it. And now we know today they have a follow-up story. He gets the all clear. We're glad that he doesn't have measles. But now they say this has inspired thousands to get their children immunized because they say this post, which went viral, systematically lists and debunks the various myths surrounding vaccinations. Really? Did she really debunk any myths? What kind of myths did she expose? Well, the idea that we all think that positive thoughts and laws of attraction and dancing by candlelight on a full moon, somehow those of us who question the safety and the efficacy of vaccines think that dancing by candlelight under the full moon is going to protect our children. No, that's a really dangerous straw man argument. It's obviously absurd. That's not what we believe. Yet what she believes is the power of the collective to dictate to you what you should do in your private life. She says, "You have stood on the shoulders of our collective protection for too long. It's a privilege," she says. A privilege, of course, not an individual fundamental right to have informed consent, because we are thinking individuals who need to have that as a protection against the kind of medical tyranny that we saw in Nazi Germany, for example. But she also goes on to say that she is protecting us by being a concerned world citizen, as all these others who get their vaccines. Well, there's a lot of nonsense in that post, and of course, she doesn't give any reasons for why she believes vaccines are safe. She doesn't point to any studies, because there's a lot of studies that haven't been done looking at both the effectiveness and the safety of vaccines. She doesn't have any studies to point to. Nevertheless, she says, "You're not endangered because science." That's it. That's the refutation. Just putting science in uppercase. Well, it turns out there's some concerned moms on the other side. And the way they put it was this. They did some research on who this lady is, and they said, this is compiled by a dedicated group of moms who are done being shamed for not poisoning our children with vaccines. What they did was they looked at her connections just by examining her Facebook accounts. It's amazing what you can find out about people with Facebook and a little bit of searching. What they found out was that her father is actually a managing partner of a partnership run by RBC, the bank. They have stock in a company called Chorus Pharma, which actually sells vaccines. Furthermore, she's got a lot of friends on Facebook who are part of the pharmaceutical industry. So she's not exactly simply a mom. She's somebody that has financial interests in her family in the pharmaceutical industry. As one of her Facebook friends, Edward Stowe, said, "Seconded heavily and with severe prejudice. Jen, may I share this on my LinkedIn feed amongst my pharma industry peers?" There you go. With severe prejudice, he agrees with her, and that's the point. There's a lot of religion and prejudice being exhibited towards people who have concerns about the pharmaceutical industry based on its long history of putting things out that have not been vetted for safety, have not been proven to be effective. As we pointed out many times, in 2011, as well as other times, there have been a large number of people who have been part of these measles outbreaks who have been vaccinated. It's not effective. Half of the people in 1987 that came down with measles in the United States, 52% actually, had been vaccinated. In 2011, patient zero was twice vaccinated, and so were the people that they passed it on to. All of the people that patient zero passed on measles to had been vaccinated. Now we see, however, that the FAA has come up with another novel approach. It's not just naming, shaming, and blaming unvaccinated people for measles, saying that we're going to kill everyone when measles hasn't killed anyone for the last 10 years. However, the measles vaccinations have. Nevertheless, we've got a new wrinkle. It's not just kicking people out of school. It's not just shaming them. It's not turning them into vax offenders, reporting them like we do sex offenders, listing them on the internet. No, now the FAA is getting into the job here of going after people, trying to force us to use Big Pharma's products. Airlines are now considering requiring proof of vaccination for domestic air travel. They say traveling by air may get more complicated if a reported plan by major carrier airlines requiring passengers to be vaccinated comes to fruition. After the increasing problem of unvaccinated individuals contracting and spreading communicable diseases, wait a minute, right there. Is there an increasing problem of unvaccinated individuals spreading the disease? I thought the CDC said that measles had been stopped endemically in the United States and that it was brought in by somebody from outside of the country because we had basically stopped it here with their vaccines. So why don't they stop people from coming into the country if they're going to do something with airplanes? Nevertheless, they're creating a straw man argument, and you see that it is not the commercial airlines that are pushing this, but the FAA. They say the FAA is suggesting that, quote, multiple major carriers have begun discussing requiring vaccination records for all passengers before allowing them to board a flight. Really? Is it really coming from the carriers, or is it coming from the FAA? Because the FAA is the one that contacted National Report and gave them this information. And they said, of course, this is the FAA still talking. It'll add another step to the flight process, but the airlines, so far, are willing to absorb any costs associated with it. See, this is being pushed by the federal government. It's being pushed by the federal government because they want to force people to buy the products of their corporate sponsors, Big Pharma. Now, we see that the FAA is extending their jurisdiction not only over unvaccinated patients, but also even over model airplanes. And this is something that even if you're not concerned about drones, even if you don't do it as a hobby, you don't want to do it as a small business, you should still be aware of how government bureaucracies metastasize, how they're constantly extending their jurisdiction. We see this happening with the FCC trying to extend its jurisdiction over the internet, saying that they're going to do it to give us net neutrality. They've been on both sides of that issue. They will change just like that once they get authority. We see the FEC saying that they want to exercise content control over political discussions in the media. And now we see that the FAA is not only going to come after unvaccinated people, say that you cannot travel, but now they're also coming after people who are using small model planes, things under 55 pounds, all the way down to essentially paper airplanes. Yes, that's what the NTSB judge said. We had a report that aired last Friday talking about how they had tried to extend their jurisdiction. They came after a man, tried to fine him $10,000 because he was flying a 5-pound styrofoam recording vehicle. They were slapped down by the NTSC judge, said there is no FAA endorsable rule or legislation that you could use for this. Said if you use this argument that you're trying to put forward, you would be regulating or asserting that you have the power to regulate even paper airplanes. And that's precisely what they proceeded to do. They had just a few rules that they put in last fall. We saw just as we were doing that report last week, back in February the 10th, the Washington Post reported that they had 33 very detailed rules. These rules were turned over to them by a realtor who had applied to the FAA for permission to fly a 3-pound Phantom UAV drone and take pictures of real estate locations. He got 33 requirements from them, and they went through in a very detailed article talking about the different things that they would have to have in terms of speed limits. They couldn't go faster than 33. Now we have some new rules that are coming out. They've upped the speed limit. They've upped the distance that he could go. He couldn't go before more than 300 feet. Now he can go up to 500 feet. Used to have, in his qualifications, he not only had to have someone flying this little 3-pound Phantom model plane with a camera on it, he had to have a licensed pilot, licensed to fly a regular plane, and an observer there. And they had to have a flight plan registered with the FAA before they took off, record keeping, on and on and on, a very detailed list. People began to push back. But the FAA wanted to extend their jurisdiction. So what they did was they've now released some rules that they have scaled back. So they take two steps forward, one step back. That's the way they extend their jurisdiction. So now we're seeing in reports today from the Wall Street Journal and from Popular Science, as Popular Science puts it out, as what you want to know about the FAA's new drone rules. They say they are a big flying deal. They say that you have to still get a license. You still have to be vetted, get this, by the TSA. You have to have an operator certificate with the UAS rating. You have to pass an exam once every 24 months. In other words, it's like a car driving license. This is the way the bureaucracies creep. This is the way the out-of-control bureaucracies continue to extend their little bureaucratic empires. And as the Wall Street Journal points out, some people are saying, oh, this is great. They've pulled back on these rules, as I pointed out before. First, they go over with really draconian, detailed legislation, and then they, not even legislation, regulation. Then they step it back a couple of notches. People say, oh, that's great. We can live with this. Not so quickly. As they point out, the rules that they've seen now, many people have said, would limit commercial drone applications, including filmmaking, delivering packages, news reporting, that's the big one. They don't want us taking pictures of what they're doing. And, of course, monitoring crops at private farms, large farms, inspecting power lines, inspecting pipelines. And, of course, Amazon.com has weighed in and said that it would ground their attempts to deliver packages with unmanned vehicles. They call that Prime Air. They released that a few months ago. And they said the FAA needs to begin to expeditiously complete the formal process to address the needs of our business. That's right. When a large company like Amazon kicks in, then perhaps something will be done because they could care less about individual rights. We're going to talk more about individual rights right after the break. We're going to talk about Obama's executive orders, CISPA by executive order, and another case of the NSA being caught with their hand in your computer. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
The knowledge of the ancients, tried and true, trusted herbs and extracts fused with the latest nutraceutical science. Introducing the all-new Ancient Defense Herbal Immunity Blend, crafted with over 14 key ancient herbs and extracts to supercharge and prepare your body for what experts admit is the most dangerous season of the year. We have rejected hundreds of other formulations in our quest to bring you what is simply the most powerful and comprehensive proprietary formula that we have ever created in the realm of herbal immunity. For the last 2 years, our team has been working with top doctors, nutritionists, and chemists to develop the ultimate nutraceutical formulation. Experience the benefits of combining over 14 ancient herbs and extracts with exciting new advances in nutraceutical science. For a limited time, get 25% off on this introductory offer. Visit AncientDefense.com or call 888-253-3139. AncientDefense.com. Used since before the days of the Roman Empire to support the body's natural systems and enhance overall health. Introducing the new InfoWarsLife.com oil of oregano formulation, a highly advanced nutraceutical form of this key herb that has been traditionally used by civilizations for thousands of years to promote health. We have now procured the most high quality and potent forms of oregano oil on the market, sourced from top leading manufacturers to ensure a concentrated level of bioactive ingredients. Extracted directly from the wild herb and sealed in easy-to-use capsules, you will no longer need to endure the burning of liquid oregano on the tongue. Wild-crafted from the Mediterranean oregano species that experts agree is one of the most powerful and most challenging to acquire. This winter season, it's more important than ever to secure this true form of oil of oregano. Now available in our limited first run at InfoWarsLife.com. That's InfoWarsLife.com or call 888-253-3139.
Well, the way that large corporations have typically worked the government to take out their smaller competitors has been to get the government to enact taxes and regulations and then to find a way to exempt themselves. Now we've had a different model. They've gotten more aggressive. As we were talking in the last segment about the vaccine companies putting pressure through many different government agencies to essentially take away informed consent from patients. That's what we see with this vaccine push. That's what we saw with Obamacare, forcing us to buy their products. Now, it was just last August that we saw a report from USA Today saying that the 20 big profitable U.S. companies that paid no taxes, and as you can see right there in that picture, the number one is Merck. If we look at the list, Merck had in one quarter $2 billion worth of profits and paid zero taxes. The number two company right behind them was Seagate, $320 million in just one quarter and no taxes. As a matter of fact, what they said was they had a tax rate of zero or lower. Maybe they got money back, like an earned income tax credit. Seagate is in the news again, just like Merck. Now they're in the news, though, in terms of spying for the U.S. government. Russian researchers exposed breakthrough U.S. spying program. The NSA has figured out how to hide spying software deep within hard drives made by Western Digital, Seagate, Toshiba, and others. This is a report from Reuters. They say this was discovered by Kaspersky Lab, the Moscow-based security software maker that has exposed a series of Western cyber espionage operations. They say the firm has declined to publicly name the country behind the spying campaign, but said it was closely linked to Stuxnet, the NSA-led cyber weapon that was used to attack Iran's uranium enrichment facility. So we're not naming any names, but we're just pointing out that the way this thing works is exactly like Stuxnet. It looks like it has the same creator. And of course, everybody except Fox News knows that the NSA created Stuxnet. We're still hearing from Fox News that because of Stuxnet, we need to turn over control of the internet to the NSA, as if we were the victims of Stuxnet. No, actually, that was genuine cyber terrorism, going after infrastructure, not just any infrastructure, but nuclear facilities in Iran. The report on InfoWars.com says Moscow-based security firm reveals what may be the biggest NSA backdoor exploit ever. And in this article from Zero Hedge, they point out that it survives military-grade disk wiping and reformatting. It covers every hard drive manufacturer, essentially, and they say that the way that this works is they've essentially put this spyware into the firmware that boots up the hard disk drive. Every time you turn on a hard disk drive, there's a bootstrap program that runs out of firmware that goes to a particular location and loads the software that has been loaded there to run the actual operation. So it's kind of they call that a bootstrap operation. By putting this in firmware, that means no matter what you do in terms of erasing content off of the actual disks themselves, that firmware is still going to have that software there. Was this put in with collusion by Seagate, by Western Digital, by these American companies? Or is this something that the NSA put in? You know, we reported a couple of years ago how the NSA was putting things into not only internet providers, but also going into computers and replacing hardware as it was being shipped. Going back to this report on InfoWars back in October 20th of 2014, they were saying that the infiltration of undercover agents into corporate entities, offensive cyber warfare and computer network exploitation, theoretical and practical aspects of encryption cracking, and supply chain interdiction operations that focused on modifying equipment in a target's supply chain. So how does this work? Basically, we had reported on it even earlier than that, a year earlier. We had this story from Kurt Nemo pointing out in his story, NSA not only snooping, but infecting computer networks worldwide. He pointed out the NSA has a special department dedicated to malicious hacking, the Tailored Access Operation, or TAO. It has more than 1,000 hackers hired to go after targeted networks. And in August, the Washington Post reported that TAO had installed an estimated 20,000 implants beginning in 2008. And as the German paper Der Spiegel pointed out, they will physically intercept packages of computers, of hard drives, of equipment used by internet service providers to put their bugs in. In other words, breaking and entering physically, not just coming into your computer. And of course, we have the tacit cooperation of many of the software providers sharing information with the government. Nevertheless, they want to try to give them legal immunity from lawsuits, from breaking the law. That's what CISPA has been about. And it's been rejected twice when they tried to pass it through the legislature. So what has Obama done? Last Friday, he signed an executive order that essentially puts CISPA through. Obama's new order urges companies to share cyber threat information with the government. They say that his new executive order is aimed at facilitating the sharing of information about cyber threats between private sector companies and the government. But it's not just sharing information about threats. It's sharing all of your information. As they point out, though, this is going to establish Homeland Security as the entity that is going to be sharing the information back and forth. And of course, that information, from what we know about the federal government, is going to be going one way. I don't think the federal government is going to be telling anyone too much about what they know. They're going to be vacuuming up all the information that Google and anyone else who will spy for them will turn over. But they say this is going through Homeland Security, and Wired magazine makes the observation that this is no doubt designed to alleviate fears about the NSA taking a lead role and possibly using the information for surveillance purposes. Give me a break. Homeland Security is no more trustworthy than the NSA, and of course this is going to be used for surveillance. How are they going to use this? Well, we have the fact sheet from the White House, which essentially says that they're going to set up ISAOs, information sharing organizations. And of course, they're going to serve as focal points. They're going to collect the information from all the people that you have any contact with, every corporation, every business that you have contact with, and then they're going to turn that over to information sharing and analysis centers, ISACs. They're creating, as we've pointed out many times, a vast infrastructure for Orwellian surveillance. It's here, it's working, they're just elaborating on it and giving protection to the companies that are the Quisling collaborators with them. Now stay with us. Right after the break, we're going to have a special report from Rob Due. Of course, we've seen Elizabeth Warren say that we need to stop the effort to audit the banks because we don't want to interfere with the Fed's monetary policies. We wouldn't want to have Congress, our elected representatives, doing that. She's also sucked up to the military-industrial complex, and now she's held hearings sucking up to the pharmaceutical industry. It looks like she wants to be president in the worst way. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
For all of recorded history, civilizations around the world praised the health benefits of silver. At InfoWars Life, our mission is to bring you the highest quality, purest, cleanest, effective colloidal silver on the market today for the lowest price available. You don't have to be a doctor to know. The fall and winter months are the most dangerous time of year in North America when it comes to you and your family's health. InfoWarsLife.com is very excited to announce our biggest run yet of Silver Bullet Colloidal Silver, exclusively available at InfoWarsLife.com. Now, InfoWarsLife.com has taken colloidal silver to the next level using a cutting-edge technique that is free of toxic artificial additives. Now more than ever, it's important to stock up on high-quality Silver Bullet from InfoWarsLife.com. And to help others during Christmas by teaching them about the powerful benefits of silver. Secure your silver bullet today at InfoWarsLife.com or by calling toll-free 888-253-3139. Introducing Secret 12, the new InfoWars Life vitamin B12 formulation. Most forms of vitamin B12 are highly processed and synthetic and cannot be properly absorbed by the body. That's why for real results, so many are having to turn to painful B12 injections, which are known to have higher absorption rates. Now, InfoWarsLife.com is excited to announce that we can bring you our most bioactive, powerful form of B12 that has been developed with our exclusive perfected process. Secret 12 is a binary of nutraceutical grade, bioavailable coenzyme forms of B12, methylcobalamin, the same kind used in B12 injections, and adenosyl cobalamin. Secret 12 is simply taken by mouth, right on the tongue, and then swallowed. No needles, no injections. Don't take my word for it. Try it for yourself. Discover the secret. Secret 12. Secure your revolutionary Secret 12 formula right now at InfoWarsLife.com or call 888-253-3139.
This is Rob Due for InfoWars.com and InfoWars Nightly News. This is going to be another vaccine report, and I hope at the end of this report that you will come to realize that just because we don't agree with the medical establishment, that we aren't wrong, we aren't crazy, we aren't conspiracy theorists, and that there's a lot of facts and a lot of studies behind the reasoning for people not wanting to vaccinate themselves and their children. So I hope this report will put all that to rest and all the vaccine pushing and all the vaccine hysteria that's going on in this country. Because this is a first step on a long line of tyrannies that are lined up if they get this, if they get their way. If they're able to push mandatory vaccines onto people, it's over for everything.
You see some of the largest outbreaks in states where they have personal health exemptions or religious exemptions. Do we need to rethink those?
We're going to start this off with a little exchange between Senator Elizabeth Warren and Dr. Shuchat, who works at the CDC. This is what I call the beauty pageant of vaccines. They throw softball questions at the officials, and the officials throw back the canned answers. So let's look at this exchange.
Dr. Shuchat, you are the top immunization official in the United States. I just want to walk through the science on this with you. Is there any scientific evidence that vaccines cause autism?
No.
Is there any scientific evidence that vaccines cause profound mental disorders?
No, but some of the diseases we vaccinate against can.
Is there any scientific evidence that vaccines have contributed to the rise in allergies or autoimmune disorders among kids?
No.
Are there additives or preservatives in vaccines that can be toxic to kids?
No, not in the amounts that they're in vaccines.
Is there any scientific evidence that kids can develop immunity to these diseases on their own simply by eating nutritious foods or being active?
No.
How do the risks of a child responding negatively to a vaccination compare with the risks of skipping vaccinations and risking exposure to a deadly disease?
Vaccines are safe and highly effective, and it's important for parents to know they're the best way to protect their kids.
Parents should know that all of the credible scientific evidence suggests that modern vaccines are safe, modern vaccines are effective, and modern vaccines are our best chance of protecting our children from diseases that can kill them. Is that right?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
So you heard it from the officials that there's no problem with vaccines whatsoever, perfectly clean record, nothing to worry about. Go out and get your child shot up today, especially with that MMR, right? In fact, I get sent this study a lot. I'm going to read it out to you, so you can go read it yourself. Vaccines are not associated with autism. An evidence-based meta-analysis of case control and cohort studies. Basically, what this has done is three doctors looked at, 15, 20 different studies that all said vaccines are safe. So then they came up with the same conclusion that vaccines were safe. What's interesting is if you go to the epilogue of this study, one of the doctors, Dr. Guy Eslick, says this: as an epidemiologist, I believe the data that is presented in this meta-analysis. However, as a parent of three children, I have some understanding of the fears associated with reactions and effects of vaccines. My first two children had febrile seizures after routine vaccinations, one of them a serious event. These events did not stop me from vaccinating my third child, however. I did take some proactive measures to reduce the risk of similar adverse effects. I vaccinated my child in the morning so that we were aware if any early adverse reaction during the day. And I also gave my child a dose of Tylenol 30 minutes before the vaccination was given to reduce any fever that might develop after the injection. So the doctor in this study admits that two of his children had adverse reactions to vaccines, one of them very serious, yet he still vaccinated his third child. This is because of the intense programming doctors go under by this Rockefeller and Carnegie Foundation-funded medicine paradigm, which is only vaccines, only prescription drugs. That is the only thing that can save you. Nothing else. Herbal remedies don't work. Vitamins don't work. Nothing else works unless it came from a Rockefeller Foundation company or a Carnegie Foundation company. Okay? And those are your big pharma companies that exist now. These chemical giants that don't want anything out there natural. They have to synthesize everything because they're afraid of natural competition. Furthermore, in this study, they list all the studies that they look at, one of which caught my eye, and it was a population-based study of measles, mumps, and rubella vaccination and autism. One of the doctors in this, Paul Thorson, MD, is wanted by the CDC for massive fraud. He was taking funds and grants that were supposed to be given to him for research and funneling them into his personal bank accounts. How much credibility can we take in this? And now let's look at some actual studies that are being done that show vaccines do cause harm, quite contrary to what you just saw in the exchange between Senator Warren and the doctor from the CDC.
Vaccines are safe and highly effective, and it's important for parents to know they're the best way to protect their kids.
First article, Activist Post, 22 medical studies that show vaccines can cause autism. And they list the studies down here. They're in the Journals of Epidemiology, Journal of Inorganic Biochemistry, study in the Journal of Toxicology and Environmental Health. These are reputable papers. And all these say there's a problem with vaccines. Yet I guess our CDC officials didn't have time to read these studies because they don't say vaccines are safe and effective.
They're very effective, and they're very safe.
Modern vaccines are safe. Modern vaccines are effective.
Vaccine is safe and effective. And
is a safe form of flu vaccine. It's very effective in preventing the flu.
Vaccines are important, safe, and effective.
Vaccines are safe and highly effective. And
here's more. Journal of Biomedical Sciences, the Annals of Clinical Psychiatry, American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, Department of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Journal of Child Neurology, study conducted at Massachusetts General Hospital. You can read the synopsis of each one of these studies, and then it has links to these studies, so you can go read them yourself. I encourage you to do this. Spend a night. Your child's health is worth it. Let's continue. Polish study confirms vaccines can cause a large number of adverse effects. And they say, it is not reasonable to assume that manipulation of the immune system through an increasing number of vaccinations during critical periods of brain development will not result in adverse neurodevelopment outcomes. Doctors and researchers point to the worsening state of health of the child population since the 60s, which coincided with the increasingly introduced vaccinations. Allergic diseases, including asthma, autoimmune diseases, diabetes, and many neurological dysfunctions, difficulty in learning, ADD, ADHD, seizures, and autism, and chronic conditions to which attention has been brought. Here's another study out of PR Newswire. Infant vaccines produce autism symptoms in new primate study by the University of Pittsburgh scientists. And basically what they did was take the basic childhood vaccination schedule and inject it into baby monkeys. And then they watched them not develop correctly. And if you look around you, go to any public place where there are kids nowadays, you see a lot of kids that are really messed up and not acting like normal kids. You'll see it, just go out there. Here's more. MMR vaccine isn't safe after all. UK government forced to concede. A UK court has ruled that the vaccine caused severe brain damage in a boy now aged 18 and has ordered the government to pay compensation. Robert was just 13 months old when he had the MMR vaccination, and from being a healthy baby who was developing normally, he started to suffer epileptic fits and became unresponsive. Here's another study. A measles outbreak at a college with a pre-matriculation immunization requirement. In early 1988, an outbreak of 84 measles cases occurred at a college in Colorado in which over 98% of the students had documentation of adequate measles immunity. Over 70, that's 83% of the cases had been vaccinated at greater than or equal to the 12 months of age. So fully vaccinated people were still catching the measles, and they were at a 98% vaccination rate. Here's a Chinese study. Difficulties in eliminating measles and controlling rubella and mumps. A cross-sectional study of a first measles and rubella vaccination and a second measles, mumps, and rubella vaccination. The report coverage of the MR and the MMR vaccine is greater than 99% in the Zhejiang province. However, the incidence of measles, mumps, and rubella remains high. Now let's go back to the testimony of Dr. Shukit over at the CDC, and let's hear what she has to say about what happens if you don't get the measles vaccine and you get the measles. What are the complications that may occur?
Your child contracted measles in the United States, the chances of a death would be about 1 in 1,000?
That's right, but remember, there are other problems with measles, not just that rare risk of dying. There are other complications besides death. Children can get pneumonia, they can get dehydration, they can also get a neurologic problem, encephalitis, which can be quite scary and severe.
So she says death, pneumonia, encephalitis. Coincidentally, those are three things listed in the insert, which they don't show you when you go get your vaccination, of side effects that have been documented with the MMR vaccine. Makes you wonder, doesn't it? Family to receive $1.5 million in first ever vaccine autism court award. It took many years, but this occurred in 2010. It's a young lady named Hannah Poling. In July 2000, Hannah was vaccinated against 9 diseases in 1 doctor's visit. Measles, mumps, rubella, polio, varicella, diphtheria, pertussis, tetanus, and hemophilus influenza. Afterward, her health declined rapidly. She developed high fever, stopped eating, didn't respond when spoken to, and began showing signs of autism and began having screaming fits. In 2002, Hannah's parents filed an autism claim in federal vaccine court. 5 years later, the government settled the case before trial and had it sealed. Here's what Hannah's parents had to say. Her dad is actually a neurosurgeon, so these aren't just crazy parents thinking that vaccines caused the injury. Here's what they had to say in Good Morning America.
I think the bottom line is our daughter was born normal. She developed normally for the first 18 months of life. There were no signs of any underlying genetic disorder. Then she was vaccinated. She became ill. That illness eventually led to a diagnosis of autism, then later seizures. I think that's the bottom line. and that vaccines were related to her illness.
Hannah's story in many ways doesn't sound that unfamiliar to us. Seemed like a normal child and something seemed to change, didn't seem to be genetic, didn't seem to make sense. What do you believe the message is out there for other parents?
Hannah's case and as other parents out there hear her story, I think her case is echoed among thousands of other similar cases. And I know a lot of other medical experts are gonna get out there and say that this is a very unusual, oddball case. And we don't really think it is at all. I mean,
interestingly enough, if you or your child is injured by a vaccine, you have to go to a special court. And this is a court with no jury. It's got a special judge. It's different rules. And there's no reporters allowed. Nobody's allowed to even see the evidence. It's just presided over in a secret tribunal.
If federal health officials oppose compensation, the case is argued before a special master in the U.S. Claims Court. Many refer to this as vaccine court. Though it isn't a court at all, but rather an administrative procedure in which the family asks the government to admit the vaccine caused their child harm and requests compensation for the child's care. Pharmaceutical companies do not have to participate in the proceedings at all. Taxpayers pay for all damages. The U.S. Department of Justice acts as the government's lawyer, with taxpayers footing the bill for their defense. The family's attorney is paid out of the trust fund, administered by the Department of Health and Human Services. There's no required discovery process, so potentially incriminating documents stay hidden in the hands of the vaccine manufacturers. Most hearings are off limits. No public, no reporters. There's no judge or jury. A special master appointed by the U.S. Court of Federal Claims both presides over the hearings and issues the rulings, which can limit the chance of an objective verdict.
Since 1989, this court has awarded over $2.6 billion to people injured by vaccines. Doesn't sound very safe and effective to me. And this is money that you and I have to pay. This doesn't come out of the drug company's pockets. This is paid for by the federal government. Remember that. And this is from the Health Resources and Services Administration, National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program Statistics Report, issued March 5th, 2014. Very current statistics, not even a year old. Now let's go over to Europe. MMR, a mother's victory. Valentino Boca was never the same child after the jab in his arm. He developed autism, and in a landmark judgment, a judge has ruled that his devastating disability was provoked by the inoculation against measles, mumps, and rubella. That's the MMR vaccine that they say is safe and effective. Okay, so they've awarded his family over $1 million. Here's another one. U.S. media blackout. Italian courts rule vaccines cause autism. The Italian infant plaintiff received 3 doses of GlaxoSmithKline Inference Hexa, a hexavalent vaccine administered in the first year of life. These doses occurred from March to October 2006. The child regressed into autism shortly after receiving the 3 doses. Presiding Judge Nicola DeLeo considered another piece of damning evidence, a 1,200-page confidential GlaxoSmithKline report. The industry document provided ample evidence of adverse reactions from the vaccine, including 5 known cases of autism resulting from the vaccine's administration during its clinical trials. So they've known back in the trials that there's problems with these vaccines, yet they keep pushing them. They keep ramping them up. They keep giving you more. Why is that?
H.G. Wells, Aldous Huxley, Bertrand Russell, and hundreds of other eugenicists constantly bragged about how the establishment believed themselves to be a separate, more advanced species than the common man. Top eugenicists were bold enough to admit that their real goal was not improving the heredity of the commoner, but to further dumb them down so that they could be more manageable. Nobel Prize winner Russell wrote at length about how vaccinations filled with mercury and other brain-damaging compounds would induce partial chemical lobotomies and develop a servile zombie population.
Diet, injections, and injunctions will combine from a very early age to produce the sort of character and the sort of beliefs that the authorities consider desirable, and any serious criticism of the powers that be will become psychologically impossible. Bertrand Russell.
So they knew in clinical trials that that hexavalent vaccine could cause autism, yet they continued with it. There's a 1,200-page memo talking about it, and they hid it from the public because they don't want you to know that vaccines are dangerous, They're not safe and effective, especially the way they're currently made with these multi-dose when you're injecting several different live viruses into your body. They're not safe and they're not effective. And now let's look at Dr. Andrew Wakefield. This is the discredited man that they talk about so often in all these reports, articles, television specials, congressional hearings. In fact, here's Dr. Shukat talking about him once again.
Autism is a terrible condition. That paper that you're mentioning has been totally discredited. It was found to be fraudulent, and it's not the case. There have been dozens of studies of vaccines and the question of autism. Vaccines don't cause autism. They are highly effective and safe and are a good way to protect your children from vaccine-preventable diseases.
That article was just flat wrong.
That's right.
And that numerous studies have showed that it was wrong.
That's right.
And what happened to the author of the article?
He lost his medical license.
Because why?
Because of the fraudulent behavior.
Totally discredited. Nothing more to see here. Move along. But British court throws out conviction of autism vaccine MD, Andrew Wakefield's co-author, completely exonerated. Gastroenterologist Professor John Walker Smith won his appeal against the United Kingdom's General Medical Council Regulatory Board that had ruled against both him and Andrew Wakefield for their roles in the 1998 Lancet MMR paper, which raised the question about a link to autism. Justice John Minning ruled that the panel's determination cannot stand, therefore I quash it, he said. Its conclusions were based on inadequate and superficial reasoning, in a number of instances, a wrong conclusion. The verdict restores Walker Smith's name to the medical registry and his reputation to the medical community. Now, we had Dr. Wakefield on the show recently, and this is what he had to say about his version of this.
We listened to parents who said that my child was perfectly normal, I'm not anti-vaccine, I took my child to get vaccinated. When I did that, they got the MMR and they regressed into autism. And they also developed gastrointestinal symptoms. And as a physician interested in gastrointestinal disease, I recommended those children should get investigated for that. They were investigated by the world's leading pediatric gastroenterologist at the time, Professor Walker Smith, who you've just mentioned, my co-author on the paper, and he found that they had an inflammatory bowel disease. We treated that disease. Not only did the bowel disease symptoms improve, but the behavioral and autistic symptoms improved. It was the beginning of a fascinating journey, but we had to investigate whether the parents were also right about whether the vaccine had precipitated in this. That's when the problem started. And so Murdoch's brought his team of journalists along, Brian Deer. They came up with this extraordinary story that we had involved ourselves in fraud and deception, that we had made it up, there was no ethical approval, all of this kind of thing, while at the same time holding back from the General Medical Council inquiry vital documents that showed there was indeed ethical approval for this study. He knew throughout the investigation and the proceedings that he had in his possession key documents. That was an obstruction of justice.
And here's an article from 2013 proving that Andrew Wakefield should have been exonerated back then. But, of course, we have to keep him out there as the boogeyman. We can't have somebody stepping in on Big Pharma's money-making machine. New published study verifies Andrew Wakefield's research on autism again. MMR causes autism. A December 13, 2012 vaccine court ruling, hundreds of thousands of dollars were awarded to Ryan Mojabi, whose parents describe how the MMR vaccine caused a severe debilitating injury to his brain diagnosed as autism spectrum disorder.
Is there any scientific evidence that vaccines cause autism?
No.
Later the same month, the government suffered a second major defeat when Emily Moyer from Houston won compensation following a vaccine-related brain injury that once again involved the MMR and resulted in autism. And you could go down and read all the links for yourself. I encourage you to do it, okay? I'm just going to keep putting out this evidence as long as the mainstream media is pushing that vaccines are safe and effective and that people who don't vaccinate their children should be forced to. I'm not going to stop talking about this.
They're very effective and they're very safe.
Modern vaccines are safe. Modern vaccines are effective.
Vaccine is safe and effective. And
is a safe form of flu vaccine. It's very effective in preventing the flu.
Vaccines are important, safe, and effective.
Vaccines are safe and highly effective. And
they're saying by the year 2020, 1 in 10 children will be diagnosed with autism. Don't you want to know why? Have you ever thought about that? I mean, that's not the world that I grew up in. I was born in the 70s. Autism was a rare thing. You never heard about it. It wasn't until the late 80s that we started hearing about autism, right about the time the movie Rain Man came out. Sort of like a predictive programming vessel to implant in you, hey, if your kid gets autism, he might be pretty cool and be able to count things out and remember interesting facts and answer questions and be really good at music. You know, they don't tell you about all the other horrible things, where he won't relate to society, you have to change his diapers regularly, he can't feed himself, just all the other debilitating effects. No, they try to make it cool and trendy. Well, let's look at that right now. Here from Dynamic Chiropractic, an interesting study published in the Human Experimental Toxicology demonstrated a positive relationship between the number of vaccine doses given to infants and infant mortality rates. In other words, the nations with the highest amount of required immunizations had the highest infant mortality rates. For example, nations like Netherlands, Canada, Australia, and the United States, which require 24 to 26 vaccine doses, have the highest infant mortality rates. In contrast, nations like Sweden, Japan, Iceland, Norway, that average 12 required vaccine doses, have the lowest infant mortality rates. Ironically, the U.S. has one of the highest infant mortality rates out of 34 nations surveyed. A companion study also noticed a positive relationship between the number of vaccine doses and hospitalization rates of U.S. children. The researchers examined the records from the government's own vaccine adverse reporting system and found that the more vaccines a child receives in earlier life, the more likely the child was to suffer a reaction requiring hospitalization. Well, there you go. More money for big pharma because of more vaccines. It's a very devious program they're running here. David Kessler, a former FDA commissioner, estimated only 6% of all vaccine adverse events are reported. So that means 94% of these adverse reactions are parents that don't even know what's going on. Their kids throwing fits, having fevers, and they don't even report it. They just try to get through it. That has got to scare you. And here we go to the boom. EPA study. Autism boom began in 1988. Environmental factors are assumed. That's right. It has to be something from the environment. And maybe it is. Maybe it's those extra vaccines. In fact, from Mercola.com is the alarming rise in autism linked to 1988 event. The first conjugate vaccine against influenza type B, HIB, was approved for use in the U.S. in 1988, which coincides with the marked increase in reported prevalence of autism spectrum disorders among American children. Researchers hypothesize that the HIB vaccine may be in part responsible for this rise in autism, as conjugate vaccines appear to have a profound impact on neurological development. These vaccines fundamentally change the manner in which the immune system of infants and young children function, the authors of a recent study say. And if you look at a graph that shows autism, it's like this, real low, real low. It starts to rise a little bit in the 80s, probably due to the increased vaccine schedule. And then at the end of the 80s, boom, it starts shooting up. And now we're almost to 1 in 10. Doesn't that make you happy? We're going to be number one in autism. Now I want to get to the end here. This is an article by Dr. Russell Blaylock, MD. We've had him on the show many times. Retired neurosurgeon, just an expert on what goes on in the brain and what affects the brain. The danger of excessive vaccination during brain development. He published this in 2008. Okay, this is a thick article. Look at this. Very thick article. It's got sections like scientific double standards of vaccine safety, compelling link between autism and the vaccination program, the autism disaster, is it man-made? Immune dysfunction, the result of bystander damage. How immune reactions to vaccines differ depending on age. Autistic children more prone to develop autoimmune diseases and infections. Immune suppressions by live virus-containing vaccines, which is almost every vaccine contains a live virus. Avoid the flu vaccine during pregnancy. Contrary to what they tell you now, you gotta get that flu vaccine. We gotta inject mercury into your baby. What about the adjuvants used in vaccines? I mean, this covers the entire study of what these vaccine ingredients and the live viruses themselves do to your brain and its development. You need to read this one if you read nothing else. And I wanna end this little vaccine extravaganza with a quote from Gandhi. Gandhi's anti-vaccine views ring true a century later. That's right, Gandhi was not a big fan of vaccines because he saw what they did to his people, and they're still hurting his people today with the Bill Gates polio vaccine. Vaccination is a barbarous practice and one of the most fatal of all delusions current in our time. Conscientious objectors to vaccination should stand alone, if need be, against the whole world in defense of their conviction. And that's what I want you to do out there. If you feel like you're alone, just stand up. You will find others out there that are like you, others that don't want to bow down to this forced vaccination program. Because once they force vaccines, they could force drug you, then they could take your children away, then they could tell you where you're going to work, how you're going to work, what kind of house you're going to have, what kind of fuel you could burn in your fireplace, and then they're going to start rounding you up and killing you like cattle when they don't need you anymore. So you can't let government start now. You got to stop them in their tracks. So you need to support legislation out there and support congressmen and senators out there that are for parental choice, because we should all have the choice whether we inject live viruses into our body or not. This has been Rob Dew with InfoWars.com and InfoWars Nightly News. Please spread this report around to everybody you know. I tried to make it the most comprehensive and as short as possible with our current attention deficit disorder we have out there. With all the people, myself included, I get a little scatterbrained. But please, spread this information. Make it go viral, okay? Make it go viral. Get it out there. Let's change the way people think about vaccines, because they're not safe and they're not effective, especially in the current way they're being used. And also, consider becoming a member of PrisonPlanet.tv. Your membership can be shared with up to 20 people at a time. So that's 20 people for the price of one, and allows you to download the movies, download the special reports, put them on DVDs, put them on your Access cable shows. Let's start informing people, because there is a war for your mind and your soul, and it's happening right now, and you either get in the game or you will get run over by the New World Order. Thank you.
Well, that's it for tonight's news. If you're watching this on YouTube, please subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you're not a Prison Planet TV subscriber, please subscribe to that and support our operation. Your contribution helps to fund us. And of course, you can share that with up to 20 people. You can watch the news each night as it's happening and share all of Alex Jones's documentaries with those 20 people simultaneously. Join us again tomorrow night at 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.
In the past decade, we have witnessed unparalleled scientific discoveries in the area of health. But no one has put together a formula that focuses directly on brain health, nerve growth factors, and optimizing your cellular energy at the same time. DNA Force is one of the most expensive formulas to produce. Some of the ingredients in DNA Force are $12,000 a kilogram. We are using the coveted, patented, only American source of PQQ, CoQ10, and more. You want the best that's out there at the lowest price anywhere? Well, we're bringing you a total win-win. The ultimate value, cutting-edge, trailblazing game changer that also supports the InfoWar. We have produced a limited run of DNA Force, and it will take up to 12 weeks to produce more once we sell out. Secure your DNA Force today at InfoWarsLife.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. DNA Force from InfoWars Life.
You are watching the InfoWars Nightly News, which airs 7 p.m. Central at InfoWarsNews.com. And your support is helping us defend liberty worldwide.